All right, guys, thanks for coming out again. We got a real good one here with John and crew. I've been waiting for this one for a while, actually. It looks like a wicked Vol-Biv all the way from the Chilko Lake. Yeah, so if everyone's gets heated, you know, we'll get the show on the road. Get down here, John. There you go, man. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Greg. Hello, everybody.
I would love to tell you about a little journey my friends and I went on. The last summer, 2022, late July, we decided to pretty much head into the wilderness, I guess you could say, on a little adventure we planned about a half year prior. So we're going to walk you through. Our journey and what it took to prepare for it. And here we go. I'll start off with a little intro video for you.
Just close up. Alright. Bushman. Out from Rainbow Creek. Got a couple of kilometers down to the Chilko Lake.
Friesen and I, November of 2021,
We got together at Tom's house. He fed us some glorious food and had a few beers together. That's creative. I think between James, Tom, and myself, we like to think outside of the box a little bit. We don't want to just go and fly some giant milk run for like 5-7 days straight. So let's do something creative. Bringing it back even a few years earlier than that, James and I remember discussing like, what's the most, like, what's the biggest, most grand thing you could achieve in a paraglider to British Columbia? And living in the coast range, we were kind of thinking like, oh, Mount Waddington. I don't know if anybody knows where Mount Waddington is. If you don't, look it up. It's kind of more of a fantasy. Like, okay, so we drew a little line on the map. How would we get to Mount Waddington? So we never even got there, realistically, on a map, without running into numerous cruxes. But what we did find while we were planning on the fall evening in 2021 was that we could get part of the way there and have probably just a lovely adventure. And that ended up being Chilko Lake. So here we are in Pemberton, British Columbia, down here. That's Mackenzie Launch. So what we did is we didn't know how long it was going to take us. In theory, you could fly this in a day if you're a really, really hot pilot. So then I think we clocked it out, it's like 170 plus clicks. This line basically, as you see it, follow it through the mountains. It's about 125 clicks from Pemberton to Chilko Lake as the crow flies. So we figured, okay, it's pretty deep wilderness out there. Let's prepare for a week's worth of adventure. Like, we want Chilko Lake. How are we going to get there? Well, the only way you're going to get there is prepare for days and days of hiking and living in the mountains. So that's just what we did. Good to go.
So we only had a Tom week.
We only had one Tom week. And it was set. So we were lucky enough this year, last year, that the weather looked pretty well. Perfect for it. It didn't look epic. We were kind of hoping going into the trip, like, okay, we want some magic day. We want two magic days of flying so we could fly over some of the gigantic cruxes that we have to fly over. We didn't really get that, but out of that, we got 5 days worth of flying and traveling through the mountains. So I'll just run it over for you here. So Pemberton, day one, we did pretty light duty travel, and we were only managing to camp on Goat Ridge, which for any of you who have flown Pemberton, it's about 25 kilometers from launch. So that to us was pretty disappointing. to say the least, because we needed to go all the way up here, and this is the most rugged part of the journey, and we only got to here, and okay, there's 1 day's worth of food done. so yeah, day two, day three, day four, full of stories, full of really great times. The rest of the route, basically, as we planned it, We've had numerous different options to take. The first trucks is getting from the main Pemberton Meadows Valley and the Lillooet River. How do we get to the Chilcotin side of Bridge River? So we chose to go through a Thalpi Pass for numerous reasons. You could take other directions. They might be a little more committing and they might be less optimal in most cases. After that, there's, again, a few different options we could have taken up towards what was day three. We chose a creek to enter the Chilcotin Range that was pretty direct, made a lot of sense, took us into High Mountain Pass area. We didn't really know if that was going to work out very well in our favor. There was a lot of snow last year. After that, the big obvious crux was crossing the Lord River into St. Clair Lakes. So yeah, you can see the little nose pointer up there.
Yeah, that was a big one. And then to finalize our journey, we basically went straight towards the Chilkazan Valley, which is in between Chilko Lakes and Chilliwack Lake. Or sorry, not Chilliwack Lake, Chilko Lake. I don't know why. Anyway, we had our heart set on the Chilkazan Valley for numerous reasons. It was kind of a natural handrail, and then one kind of up and over to get to Chilliwack Lake, or sorry, Chilko Lake.
Keep it chill.
Anyway, yeah, so I'm going to get Tom to run you through some logistics of how we broke down this route, and our different options, and how long it would possibly take to get out of some of these places.
Cheers, Tom.
We sit in the middle, I'll drive here for a second. Awesome. So, yes, John mentioned we got together quite a number of months before Tom Week started, and having a 9-to-5 job myself, sitting in front of a computer, gives you lots of time to sleuth and plan. So, though we did a lot of this work together, breaking down a line like this, we really put it into pieces. And so looking, first at, okay, let's assume we get to Chilko Lake, and this is the line we're hoping for. What are our escape routes? And we really have sort of three distinct zones along our route. The first zone between Pemberton and Valley Pass, where if we were to land low or have to retreat, we would be escaping to Pemberton. We had the middle part in ultimately the catchment of rivers flowing down towards Lillooet, where we could exit on the north side by trails and Chilcotins, and on the south side it would be bushwhacking and logging roads down to the valley. At some stage we reached sort of our next drainage or critical point where now the escape was to the north. And so our sort of contingency planning really evolved around those different zones and how we would get out in each of those cases. For the southern part of the route, Lillooet and Pemberton, well, they're not too far from the lower mainland. We could probably call somebody to come get us, which we have had in line. But when we cross and the drainage goes to the north and our exit to the north, that kind of complicates things a little bit. So our escape route was quite lengthy and quite long to the north. A pickup to Chilko Lake, as we found some of the planning wasn't necessarily possible by road. There are roads, but there are locked gates, some 40 kilometers to the north of Chilko Lake, or not sure, and even more. 50-something. So we looked at retrieval by boat, by fixed-wing airplane, with float-plane, fixed-wheel planes, ATV, you name it. We were kind of exploring what was involved. So on the planning side, route being picked, scouring for potential LZs through aerial imagery to try and give ourselves those buffers of when we're in what zone, where are we landing, where are little islands of safety, what the conditions of the roads were, the good gates, as I mentioned, status of the trails. I called the mining exploration company and talked to some of their development managers on the status of their claims and old bridges and trails, tourism, and sort of the list goes on. And then there are things that really kind of happen much closer to the trip as you get a better feel of what conditions are going to be like. Weather notwithstanding, snowpack and river water levels had an influence on our planning. Last year, as John mentioned, we had a high snowpack and then quite a cold spring, so the snow persisted quite late. That worked in favor for the route we had planned, which had some passes were, I want to say they were lower, they were still high, but they were lower than some of the other routes. And and there was still a decent snowpack even in the last week of July when we did the trip. The water levels in some of the lakes and rivers were at their peak for the season, and some were, you know, multi-year highs during our trip, so the options were landing on gravel bars and shorelines, which can be those sort of havens of safety in areas where there aren't property and roads to land, were not available. And some of that we just found out when we were up there. On the other side of planning, you know, lots with communications, I had, you know, handwritten and digital lists of phone numbers and who to call. We each had duplicate copies of our emergency contacts and how we knew how we would contact each other if we became separated. We all had satellite messaging capability. We all had each other radios for flying communication. We had, you know, physical copies of printed out maps and things like that. And on our gear side, we were all self-sufficient. So if we were separated, we weren't reliant on one another to have specific gear. We kind of laid out very much at the get-go, and we've flown and camped together before, sort of what our ground rules are for flying as a team and what the spirit of the trip is for us. I mean, very much, it's not just about, you know, flying, so being safe and also being together as a group of friends in the mountains. So our rules were stay together, both in flight and on the ground. Someone has to land and save, we all act together. The lowest pilot in the thermal gets to make a decision on when we go on glide. My pilots don't just leave some lower behind them, and then we keep communication at all times. And those were put to the test a few times. I'm an organizer too, so I made lists and I recycled lists from years past of what I brought and had it all. I even have a checkbox for when I, you know, put it in my bag. I highlighted a couple things that were, you know, maybe different, but quite useful. The bug net was very useful. So John on video there and his tent, a little bit buggy at times. We packed like a thick garbage bag in case we need torrential rain, but also in case we need to do a major river crossing, so that we could steal our gliders in an oversized garbage bag to get across and get everything wet. And a sewing kit, handy for all sorts of things. My backpack ended up tearing in where the shoulder strap attaches to the bag, which could be quite catastrophic, carrying a bag with one strap, which I think so came very handy.
Day one.
Sorry,
John, who's the fourth?
Yes, we're going to get to that.
Yeah. So we're pretty excited, and we just arrived in the Pemberton landing zone, and we're waiting for our friends to give us a ride up, and everybody's kind of congregated there, and they're all asking us what we're doing with these big bags. And a pilot from Squamish that John knows from a previous flight came up and asked what we were up to, and he told him, and he said, "Okay, yeah, I'm coming with you."
Wait, did you just say, "I'm coming with you," and yeah, he asked, "Can I come with you?"
Well, I asked Tom this in the car on the way over, and you both agree him not really giving us an option.
It was more of a, "I'm coming with you." That's okay, right?
Yeah. So, Corey, these guys have never met Corey. I had the pleasure of a flight with Corey. I knew I've chilled with him on launch a couple times, but I had one really special flight with him maybe a month prior. So I knew Corey enough, and when he said, "Hey, can I come?" or "I'm coming," maybe if that's what he needs, he meant it, and he had the stuff to back it. So right after he says this, he's like, "You know what? Yeah, no, I'm good to go. I've got six boxes of Annie's in my van. I've got a slingshot.
we're good to go. Let's go. And you know what? He was ready to go. He had everything he needed. So we had quite the discussion. Tom, James, and I. Okay, what do we do? We've been planning this for almost a year, like months and months. We've gone over the route like really in depth, scoured on Google Earth. We know every nook and cranny of option A, B, and C. And here's this guy saying, "I'm coming." Like, are you crazy? And the thing is, he knows where Chilko Lake is too. Like, he knows what he's getting into. So anyway, that was one thing. So ultimately, I was pretty okay with it, because who are we to say, "Hey, you can't fly in the air beside us." So there's that as well. I knew him. I knew he could fly, and he did, in fact, present 6 boxes worth of handies in a sack. So ultimately, Tom and James said, "Hey, okay, you can come. Just we're gonna let you know what basically the rules are," which Tom went over. We're always sticking together. One guy lands, we all land. You split up, you're on your own, if done so voluntarily. And also it was our retrieval. One of our potential retrievals from Chilko Lake was a Cessna 182, which wouldn't have been able to carry 4 of us with our gear, plus the pilot. So we told Corey, like, if we get to Chilko Lake, you're on your own. Anyway, after all that, he's like, "Yeah, nope, okay, I'm cool." So anyway, off we went up to launch.
Yeah, so this is us all standing there in the line there. And of course, our launch was mosquito infested, and it was hot. A hot, stable day, and not much was happening in the way of flying, so we waited around for about 3 hours, and then eventually some pilots were starting to maintain and actually get a little bit higher than launch. So we decided that we'd take off. We went down the main rig line, but we weren't getting a lot of elevation, so we're pretty much scratching around. And eventually, we kind of congregated with a number of other pilots that were planning to do a weekend cap over as well. This is a early of our flight here.
That was the most exciting track to watch.
You want to describe it?
I think John mentioned his first day. Our first day was very underwhelming. Making it to GOATS, we had hoped to make it quite a bit further. For myself, I've flown Pemberton a number of times, but a lot less than a lot of people have. It was definitely the lowest I've ever flown to GOATS, ever. And I was quite certain, just a few seconds prior to this animation, that I was going to the beer farm, and somehow managed to scrape up to 1,600 meters to kind of cross over the Barber. And the only reason I think I really went is because someone had it before me, and they made it. So off we went, and gave it a try, and it worked better on the other side.
So.
So much for staying together. Someone said, "Yeah, that was busting rule number like 1 right away on the first flight." I recall Tom saying, "Well, it was only the milk run, so whatever." Fair enough. Yeah, nobody was really having a time, and might as well break rules.
Where is Corey?
Oh yeah, Corey. So he doesn't record his flights or do any of that sort. So Corey's amongst us. Just picture Corey like in between the purple, yellow, and red dots somewhere. Anyway, later after we all top-landed GOATS, here's a little clip of my rusty old camera.
Was there any wild card?
There was quite a bit.
bit of high cloud that came
oh,
in.
Oh, so fancy seeing you guys see here.
In the overexposed distance there. So anyway, we landed on GOAT with numerous other pilots, actually, and it wasn't at all what any of us, James, Tom, and I had expected at all. We're setting out on this journey, envisioning, like, okay, we're all by ourselves, and all of a sudden we're like having a party on GOAT. There were, I think, four or five other pilots that were bivvying up on GOAT that night, and I think everybody gave Copper a miss, a site where you would usually go and do a nice Vol-Biv, because it was still covered in snow, because we had exceptionally high snowpack throughout the spring and summer. Anyway, here's a few pictures of camp that evening. There's a few of the other pilots that came up for the Vol-Biv festivities for night one.
It's actually a really good option for camping because there was a pretty nice creek coming through the campsite. And for launching the next day, there's a lot of options too for aspect.
Yeah, no, I would. I've bivvied on Copper and Gingerbread Ridge, the standard Pemberton Vol Bivouac sites numerous times. And you know what? There's quite a few more that the Main Valley has to offer, and GOAT is definitely one of them. Anyway, we're on to day two. So we wake up to a pretty friendly sky. It was a nice chill morning. Yeah, I remember nothing spectacular about the morning other than relaxing, eating some nice breakfast, waiting for things to turn on. I did manage to check the forecast because we still had a bit of cell service just above the Main Valley in Pemberton. The day didn't look promising, so day two looks to me, on my phone screen anyway, identical to day one. So it was like not really an awesome thing to see. It wasn't very inspiring. Anyway, so we waited for things to turn on. There was some high cloud. You can actually see it in the distance in this picture. I think we probably launched round one. Maybe even later.
We actually debated quite heavily whether we should just pack up and hike over the hurley and hike up the other side in order to have something to do. it was looking that good. But we decided to give it a miss with potential to be able to fly over instead.
Is that looking up towards the hurley?
No.
Well, you're looking at Athelstan on the right side of the screen. That's the first ridge you run into when you fly to Athelstan. So this picture is not from Goat Ridge. In fact, it's from further along in the Elk Rep. So Mount Meager would be on your left.
So that's looking northwest.
Yeah. Yes.
This is
Meager.
Boulder.
That'd be Boulder Creek. Yeah, so as Tom was saying, the forecast looked so grim and the high cloud was in and we weren't getting good cycles. The thought of doing a sledder down to the hurley and then hiking up into the railroad group up Locomoto, and it's just like, I remember looking in James's eyes and I think I felt the same.
I really don't like hiking with a big bag.
And we're out for Chilko Lake and we want to do a sledding down to the hurley and hike up a mountain that we've all hiked up as well to cover like 10 kilometers. So that was out of the question as far as James and I were concerned. So we waited. We eventually launched into a fairly dull sky. We boated around for quite a while over GOAT itself before it actually got us to the height we wanted to cross the hurley. I remember the high cloud shading a lot of the run to the northwest out, and then all of a sudden you look up the line and Locomotive was now in the sun, so we were getting to maybe 2600 meters. So we crossed the Locomotive and started the rest of the run, a run that we would usually do in, you know, a half a day, not even. You can fly from Pemberton Mackenzie Launch to Spindrift and Athelstan on a nice day in a few hours, if it's really good. Either way, here we are on day two. We're finally into some interesting country.
I do recall this being a really, really moving time for me. Once we got past Spindrift, cross over to Athelstan, you have this feeling of actually being in the mountains and quite far out on the line, even if you're flying for a day in Pemberton and you fly to Spindrift or Athelstan, you will feel quite alive out there because, you're quite far from Pemberton by then, seemingly. So by Athelstan, that's basically the point where we say goodbye to the normal conditions one would be used to flying in Pemberton. Say having logging roads underneath you, having farmers' fields, having civilization. So once we got high in Athelstan, we basically headed due north into the Athelney Pass, which we had used a couple of years before on a Vol-Biv that we tried to get into the Chilko Lake. Anyway, very moving time once you pass a certain point like that. For me, it went from grim, okay, we've had a day and a half of like, oh, we're not getting to where we need to go, to holy, we've just crossed the line and we're in the wild. And I remember previously, 2 years ago, approaching Athelney Pass, having that same feeling of just a freeing feeling, just being out there. Okay, now none of these other things matter, like getting back to your vehicle. Like, you're out there. You're not getting back to your vehicle once you head into Athelney Pass. Like, you are now reliant on paragliding and hiking, all of that. Here's a little clip. That's another thing. I had just bought a new wing, fancy new wing that I didn't know well enough yet. I was very tempted to take it out into the wilderness because it's like, oh, it's a new sports car, like get it, drive it. I had one or two flights and they're like pathetic little flights. Like, I was really, really wanting to fly my new wing, but you know what? The depths of where we might find ourselves is not a good place to test a new wing. Anyway, back to Athelney Pass. As I was saying, most beautiful camp spot I could ever dream of. As you can see, we've got beach-like pumice, which, it's very soft, light, volcanic material. It's beautiful to set a tent up. We found absolutely level ground. Anyway, had a pleasant night. Cordy lit a fire. He did not catch any ptarmigan or any other critters. I think, as you can see, he had a fire going in that last picture. Cordy did not bring a stove. He's a very, very confident man. He's industrious. So here's this guy. He's got 6 boxes of Annie's, no stove, and here it is with us in a Bellamy Pass, and we're all having a great time.
Above the tree line.
Above the tree line, yeah. Oh, one more thing I will add about the journey into a Bellamy Pass is I'll never forget it. James coming into land in the pass, I'm kind of behind him on glide. A mama bear and her cub were startled by James. And sprinted down the side of the mountain. I don't think Jaden noticed this, but like they were running right from where he was landing. He didn't notice it, but I did, and that was very symbolic of where we were. We were now deep. We were into the journey. We couldn't just like hike out of there without a lot of effort. Anyway, on to day 3.
All right, day 3 started with the forecast of north-northwest wind, a lot of wind, unfortunately. So we had covered ground to start on the first 2 days where we had all actually flown before one time to the Bellamy Pass. So there was a certain level of familiarity, but day 3 was for us to be entering into new terrain. And as far as we knew, actually, in the terrain that people haven't flown for. From Bellamy Pass, we took us north over the Bridge River before hooking into Nichols Creek, which had no landing options for a short period below tree line. We had to then cross Griswold Pass, which is a broad pass in the Chilcones, and with the high snowpack that we had, as well as its size and relatively high elevation of about 2,000 meters, we kind of expected we would have to land the pass if we got there and walk over or to our next launch point. To boot, we learned Corey's radio battery had been fried from a botched charging attempt with a cable.
It was sliced.
And it put a new wrench in our ground rules of maintaining communication at all times. So it meant it meant unfortunately that the in-air decision making and chatter he was cut out from, and we would yell to him when we had decided what we were going to do. There were times I think I yelled to him, "What do you think?" But it's hard to sustain a conversation at
length.
I don't recall, probably, but it was the charging situation which was the problem, and I got the radio itself. From camp, we hiked for about an hour to launch. This is our route here for the day. At the bottom of the screen is our starting point just north of the Bellamy Pass. And you see our route and the forecast wind direction here. Going wrong. A lovely hike to launch. It's Bellamy Pass is a special place. And we saw evidence of our friends from the day before. Yeah, on the left you can see 2 sets of prints, a small set and a larger set. And we were heading for kind of a flank of the mountain facing southeast, a logical spot for a morning launch that would set us up for a good day of flying. But the northwest forecast wind direction meant that it was a lee side launch. When we got there, wind was coming out of the back. We set up a garbage bag for a windsock and it was limp or pointing downhill for most of the morning. And we kind of sat and waited and wondered, are we in the right place? Do we need to find another place to launch? Is this the right call? We're going in a place we've not been before. What the hell are we doing? But the scenery was spectacular. It was a great place to be. We eventually launched.
Yep. Yes, sir.
Yeah.
on there. This is a picture of the pass looking back from the way we had come. We had camped just over here. We just camped on the other side of this ridge. The Bridge River system is in the valley here. We crossed, kind of thermaled up on this peak here and crossed the pass. And these sort of zebra stripes of snow, quite spectacular. It was, a long glide, and we landed on a peak I think it's called Microscope Peak, quite low, but we had made it over the pass, sort of. John and I and Corey managed to scratch and keep our way up, make our way up and climb out. James, unfortunately, did not, and it landed. And our rules were put to the test again. We soared around for a little bit while James raided. He landed fine. We watched him land and make sure everything went okay. And as we kind of flew around in the air, we had to figure out, are we going down to land with James? That's what we said we would do.
I would never.
I wouldn't leave James. I don't blame these guys. I wouldn't have.
And we managed to justify to ourselves that we would find a good place for James to relaunch. and ultimately, Corey landed on the peak top, which put a lot on James to hike up. John and I actually spiraled down to approximately where we invited to on the mountain, lower on the mountain. And found a good relaunch spot. We figured it would be about an hour for James to hike up. And we landed there, radioed down to him, and told him where we were, and he hiked up to meet us a little over an hour later. We're still friends.
Where's Corey?
Corey's on the mountaintop with no radio.
He lands high. He lands high. I remember.
Is that the Griswold Pass area?
Yeah, that's Griswold Pass. Yes.
Yeah.
Where we're at, sir, for a little lunch. Lunch in the Chilcotins.
Wait for our buddy. We're gonna relaunch. See what happens. We got lots of hours in the day. I suspect it'll be an hour and a bit until he gets here.
Dinner somewhere else.
Yeah.
We're just getting ready.
Yeah.
So here James has caught up with us. We all launched together. Despite leaving them down in the past below, I think having us all three able to watch together from this lower part of the peak was actually quite important for us to all climb out together. Which we managed to do quite fine. Corey spotted us and relaunched from the peak to join us, and we were back in action.
Are you finding a funny monster?
was quite warm down below, so yeah, I had to move without gloves to keep him inside my jacket. All right. And then I had our monitor. Here's Corey. Change here from being up at cloud base there to being on the ground. There was a few things that happened between those times, and we were flying towards Chilko Lake, optimism high. We flown a morning flight, landed, relaunched, got to cloud base again. We were pretty stoked. But then my ground speed started to drop quite a lot. 15k an hour on the bar, and then 8k an hour. And then I got -6 meters per second sink. And in a few minutes, I was below ridge crest and fighting serious headwind. The speed dropped to 4 kilometers an hour, and then to 0 kilometers an hour. And then it went up to 4 kilometers an hour. But I realized I was going backwards. Thankfully, we weren't actually that far from the pass. We didn't make it particularly far on the second leg of our flight. So we were, above the alpine area, still some open places to land. I was able to look behind me and spot a place to put down. And I was able to put down safely in this bouldery, feathery slope at the valley. And everyone else followed down with me. We followed the rule of landing together. And we called it a day.
Where's Corey?
He's with us.
John probably chopped that tree on the way down.
Yeah, it was a good landing. So our optimism once again went from really high to what the hell are we doing?
Yeah, I think that was the first humbling moment we had of the journey. And to think you can just easily fly in this direction and into the rugged terrain that we're flying into and not be, humbled a little bit, I think that's quite optimistic. So anyway, we had a little bit of a fun time in Duane Creek, and I did karate kick a tree. It was probably like a 12-foot high sapling. It was quite bendy and soft. Quite eventful. I did not get it on film. I apologize. Anyway, pleasant night. I remember going to sleep in Duane Creek, quite worried about this crossing. The next day, we had ahead of us a decent looking flying day. I remember getting a forecast texted to my spot that looked fairly decent. I think there was a bit of northwest wind in it, if I can recall. But it looked good, as far as we knew out in Duane Creek, the day was going to be pretty decent. Okay, we're probably going to have a chance.
This was the day it was potentially to overdevelop.
Right. Yeah. Okay. I remember that. I do remember getting another text. We did have a few people texting us weather updates. That's another little detail that I think is fairly key to a trip like this. You can go out and feel the day and honestly survive just fine. But to plan your next move in mountains like these, it's kind of nice to know what you're up against as far as conditions. So anyway, yeah, as Tom was just saying, we did get a text that it might overdevelop. So we were feeling pretty uneasy. I went to bed the night prior going like, okay,
I don't know if we can make this crossing across the Lord River to St. Joe Lake. Also, I'm worried about grizzly bears because we're in just prime country for grizzly bears. So we wake up day four. We are all alive. No sign of grizzly bears. Our food's all still there. I remember waking up that morning, seeing cumulus cloud development drifting with like north-northwest wind, and going like, oh crap, yeah, it's all east side already. Like, not looking good. So I remember discussing with these guys, and I think we're all thinking like, okay, here we are at Duane Creek. Do we want to keep going? Like, this is a little wild. We're out there. We're a couple days away from civilization at best if we retreated up Slim Creek through the Chilcotins at this point, which I believe we all thought about doing. We couldn't not go up to a potential launch and just have a taste of the day. So there's a little picture, and here's a little clip.
Morning. Hike up to launch. Day four.
Late morning.
Late morning.
We're thick in Duane Creek in the Chilcotins, contemplating our crossing the Lord River, Upper Taseko Lake. Camped down in that valley down there last night, landed in strong winds. Totally parked, climbed backwards for a little bit. Everyone got down safe.
There's the other side of the Lord River. There's Corey, Birdman. We have no clue what's going to happen today. Which direction we're going to actually end up going, but going up for a take. Lee side, north-northwest wind aloft right now. Exact opposite of what we need to cross. Lord Seiko. So we'll see what happens. We might find ourselves turning tail and running up towards Sims Creek, or and hiking out, or maybe we get gifted. Gonna climb on McClure to 3,500 meters.
Here we go. For launch.
Sorry about that.
Probably on this snow slope here somewhere.
All right, so that was the hike up. I think it was probably 300 vertical meters above the valley floor or launch, so not a lot of room to start a day of flying. You know, wouldn't take much to sink out. So here we are. Here's a little bit of Tom getting off the mountainside. Sometimes it's good to be the first guy off, sometimes it is not good to be the first guy off. Lucky for Tom, he did okay. There's Corey. It was actually an exceptional launch site. We found a
nice. Yeah, one thing about our, I guess, when we launched, we basically all launched sequentially, one right after the other, in the spirit of, again, staying together and not having a that was one of the rules we of staying together. We followed it every day.
However, I remember having a really hard time climbing out on this one. I think all three of these guys got up and out. And I struggled for like seemingly forever. It was probably only like 10, 20 minutes. I had to battle to get out of here. Anyway, so our flight continues. We're all together up at a pretty decent altitude at this point. We're flying out Duane Creek. It's pretty nice handrails on Duane Creek. up to a reasonable altitude. I think we reached 34, 35.
31.
Well,
we're going for it. So we broke,
like, it wasn't technically a rule.
It was pretty
like
nervous.
Something we were going for. Like, anyway, here we are crossing that.
Sand bar down there to land on. Maybe we push back up that valley if we can't climb on that peak right there in between the two lakes.
We met some winds. So there's James making a nice landing. It was actually a beautiful place to come and land in, aside from the sludge. It was nice and open. The wind's laminar. It's basically air coming off a lake. So we made the big crossing. Corey, on the other hand, not only made the crossing of the Lord River, he actually was able to duck into the lee of that mountain we were gliding towards, and he actually ended up climbing out. Now, in the position that we were in, geographically, if you can stay in the air, keep high, go to a better place where you don't have to hike out of for hours and hours and hours, it's very tempting to do so. So he did just that. He went off on his own, and I believe in this picture here, you're looking at Tom. Behind Tom's wing,
where my cursor is where we land.
There's the marsh where we land and where the cursor is right now. And if you look at Tom's wing, Corey got a climb off of the mountain in front of Tom and then landed up high in the alpine here. So all of a sudden, okay, it's just the original three. Corey he's gone. We did exchange messages via InReach pretty much right away. He let us know he landed safely. We let him know we landed safely. What we had ahead of us now was a big hike out of the bottom of that beautiful marshy lake river delta area. And I think James is going to take you on the journey of this beautiful hike we got to have.
I'm qualified to talk about this because I like hiking the least out of all of us. And of course, the bug nets go on as soon as we land, and we pack up and immediately start trudging through the forest. It's a whole whack of deadfall jungle. And because it's more interior or a drier area, all of the roots don't have a lot of holding down. So there's big sections of deadfall where it's like becomes sticks, and it becomes immediately apparent that we are lucky that we haven't had to hike thus far with big bags that we do. So getting under big stumps and trees is very difficult, and for balancing wasn't that easy. Theoretically, we could come across game trails, so be easy for a couple meters at a time, but kind of closed out, and then just happened upon this big viewpoint of this waterfall grandfalls. And beyond this, it continued to be dense trail. And then slowly but surely, we made our way to a whole mining road that we spotted in Google Earth. And the trail got better and better as we got to that. But even on the mining road, vegetation had taken hold and was quite quite overgrown. In a couple of years, it probably might not even be able to walk that. From here, we were all sore. Our shoulders were pretty much dead. I was exhausted, and it's already about 7:30 in the evening, and you had quite a distance to go. This is us still continuing on the trail. By the time it was 10:30, we had made our destination to an old abandoned airstrip. In that area, and I was just totally destroyed. And I was debating whether we could continue doing another hike like this the next day if we had to. But Tom had. The diplomacy had suggested that we just take it one step at a time, and we decided to wake up in the morning and see how it felt.
So how heavy were your packs when you started?
I had the lightest pack. Mine was 40 pounds.
These guys 40 pounds? Too bad.
Yeah, so my bag wasn't too bad.
Did you have any food in there?
Do we tell?
I don't think we carry pictures of James' tent. Pictures of your tent?
I was particularly worried because in the forecast it said that there's a potential for overdevelopment, and I took that to mean, we possibly could get precipitation for the rest of the trip, and I didn't have a tent with me, so I would have been especially vulnerable. So I cut corners in quite a few things, but keeping my pack weight down.
Yeah. How about your overdose? Your pack?
I should probably add that.
Being so destroyed, I talked these guys into that. If we were going to continue, they were going to carry some more weight from me. We did weigh in the day before. I think my pack was 7 kilos heavier. James's. I'm weighing about 28 kilos, so I'm 65 pounds or something.
So these guys are good friends after all. Yeah, I think my pack was somewhere in between James and Tom's. I don't remember the exact number, but yeah, no, we did carry some of your food to try and coax you along. if that was what it took to say, okay, James is going to keep on trucking. Yeah, I'll carry a few bags of dehydrated food for James.
You take his food away, I follow you.
Oh, yeah. That's a good strategy. That's great. All right.
Is that Chilko Lake?
That is Chilko Lake. Yeah, so day 5 began, and you know, despite my diplomacy the night before, as Jane mentioned, not taking one step at a time, I was talking to myself, not them, because I was also feeling destroyed. And we had made an airstrip, and we had lined up a real plan that could take us out. So there was a bit of an out for us at this stage, if we want to take it. But we slept the night, woke up the next morning, and guess who was the first one up, cracking, packing, and ready to go? It was James.
Corey might not have slept. We don't know.
Yeah.
Like, we have no clue.
We're not sure where Corey is.
He could be running from a grizzly all night.
So we knew on day 5 where we hoped to launch that day. We needed to be hiking by about 7. If we wanted to be launching by noon. And we had a favorable forecast, which kind of pushed the aches and pains out of our system. We basically didn't have any good excuse to quit, other than the fear and doubt that we had every day for the previous 4 days. We did exchange messages with Corey that morning to confirm our plans, our independent plans, his and ours, and that he had arranged for the way out. After all, we don't know that about each other.
We hiked up the Texan Valley. It was actually quite civilized. It started on a bit of old road, transitioned to DC Trail, which transitioned to Pushing Trail. And at some point, we decided time to leave the trail and hike up the mountain and find a place to stop. By day five, maybe it was just fatigue, maybe, I don't know why, but we were talking about this earlier today. Things felt quite calm and a lot less intense. Maybe it was the favorable forecast, I'm not sure. But there was a level of ease that hadn't been there on previous days. This is where we camped at Fishing Lake, at a kind of fishing camp of some kind that nobody was around.
We didn't sleep in the cabins,
yeah. So the line in red is our hiking route from the night before, and Fishing Lake is here, and we hiked back in on day five, left the trail around here, and hiked up to launch on a ridge below our cap peak. More evidence of wildlife, not much evidence of footprints, human at least. Similar to everywhere else, the Chagasan River was flowing high, quite turbid. There didn't seem to be any gravel bars available for us to land on if we couldn't climb out on launch. This day was also particularly hot. We remember being very just hot and sweaty hiking up to launch. We found a nice spot. This was one of our first launches that wasn't on snow of the trip. Thankfully, we had a good favorable conditions. We spent 10 minutes or so kind of bombing some of these bigger rocks off to the side. So if anybody's up there, there's a nice clear launch there now. All the rocks are out of the way. I'm not sure what John's saying, but it's probably like, oh my god, I'm so hot right now.
Big and tight and fly.
Really hot. I'm hot too. Up and behind us, you can kind of see the terrain that we were covering.
Yeah.
Bushwhacking was not particularly terrible.
There's the woods. East. Couple light suckers generating around here.
All right, so we had actually made it to a launch over the Chaikazan Valley. Having landed in a marsh the day before by upper Teseco Lake. So that was pretty impressive to me. Like, we did quite a bit of work to get from that marsh we landed in to the camp we slept in, and then back up this valley to launch. I was so impressed with that. We were pretty much hitting brick walls, the evening before, and coming up to this launch here was like hiking in a sauna. You know, day five, I remember thinking to myself, like, I didn't even care if we get to a launch. Like, I didn't even care. Like, let's just see what happens. I'm tired, I'm kind of hot. If we made it this far, whatever. Turns out we were there by like 12:30, which is quite optimal as far as launch times go. So yeah, we did our thing, found the launch, and essentially had really good conditions on our last flight of the journey. So we'll play a little clip here. See, I remember, I forget who launched first, but these guys were both in the air. And I had a moment up above the Chaikazan Valley where I was like by myself. I didn't really know if there were any good LZs underneath me. I knew there was one clearing that I remember seeing on Google Earth that was kind of meadowy but had trees in it. All the sandbars, as Tom said, were non-existent on the river.
couple light suckers.
I don't think I've ever felt as remote as when these guys had just launched and I'm standing there by myself going like, I hope I can launch right now. I really don't want to be stuck in this mountain by myself. All rules aside. So here we are, getting into the air, day five. I've already seen these guys fly through a few bumps and lips, so I'm pretty confident fly out of time's planet dart and we're getting a nice climb from out front. I believe our first climb took us to 38.
Alright, we're flying again, day five.
Here's some commentary.
Launch from down there. Don't think we're gonna try and land at the mouth of the river. Also doesn't look like there's a ton of snow.
space because the river's so high.
So we're gonna land down here on one of these gravel bars. See how it goes. Made it to Chilko Lake! Unreal. So blue.
So we got really rewarded and very quickly we were put back in our place and had to come down through some fairly strong air. It was quite turbulent, like the biggest river bar we could find happened to be in the lee of this like 100 meter tall ridge, which was like, oh great, perfect, we've got to land on the road a bit next to fast moving silty water. Anyway, we all arrived there. I think it was Rainbow Creek, or Rainbow Creek was actually just at a confluence, a little downstream, I don't know. Either way, after that, oh, did you want to explain the bushwhack? I can explain the bushwhack. Oh, we're pretty good for food, actually. It turns out, we figured this out at Fisham Lake, the camp previous to day five. James has mistakenly brought, like, too much food.
I had 2 weeks of food.
He had ordered off of like this online site that you can order like all this dehydrated food from. He ordered like this many days worth of meals and
it's 7 days, but for two people.
Yeah. So either way, yeah, we had like days and days worth of food left. And, like,
some of those packages, they say it's for two people, and it's like really only for one person.
Oh, yeah, if you're burning calories, you're not there. Oh, still up. Anyway, yeah, we did have food left when we got to our final destination. At this point, it's kind of like, oh, cool. You know, we made it to Chilko Lake. It was actually quite exciting. We were pretty stoked. I know I was through the roof. Like it was unreal to take a line that we had kind of cooked up into the wilderness that we did and to actually achieve it. Like I think going into the trip, we all thought this is pretty improbable, but let's try anyway because we've got like a block of time. We've got some resources. We can feasibly get ourselves out of places with enough time to spare. So to make it was absolutely surreal. So here we are on Rainbow Creek, some river bar, high on life. So the next stage was to face the fact that we were not at Chilko Lake yet. Part of the logistics that we had lined up was a boat retrieval that would come down from the north end of the lake. I organized it through a lodge that operates up there. We were kind of casually talking a few weeks prior. Oh, hey, yeah, we might be able to like finish our journey at Chilko Lake. Can you pick us up on a boat? I'm like, oh yeah, that's cool. Yeah, but just to let you know, like we might not make it. Like this is not a booking. Can we text you from our interview? So anyway, they said yeah. We called that organized. We throw a text out on our satellite device, and I was pretty much thinking, okay, it's the afternoon now, I'm going to throw this message out just to let them know that the next day they can pick us up, and it's going to be awesome, great. So they text back like 10 minutes later, yeah, we'll be there in 2 hours. And it's just like, really? That was impressively fast. But like, we're like 5 kilometers away from Chilko Lake. And there's no trails. Like we've got a bushwhack, so we packed up and started bushwhacking. I think the first half of it was quite decent. Like it was nice, mature forest, open space trees. And then it just went downhill. We saw time ticking. It's like, okay, halfway through, we're good on time. I think we're making a great pace. And then the second half of it, stuff started to close in. You know, the deadfall started to get worse. The bush got thicker. I remember Alder, once we got down towards the shoreline, it was pretty much, like, horrible. I think all three of us have done some fairly legitimate bushwhacking throughout the years.
Those clothes are all gone and ripped up.
Yeah, we had to replace all that clothing because, the deadfall is sharp and dry in the Chilkoot Ranges.
Tom's impaled himself on the stump.
Any photos of that?
I don't think we got any photos of Tom on a stump.
Of
But I think we all took our turns on stumps. So there's a line of our bushwhack from where we landed to the shoreline of Chilko Lake. So the next step was, okay, we figured we'd get to the mouth of the creek where, like, you know, this kind of beach, or there's a little bit of sandbar, which was underwater, but it was still, like, I envisioned it to be, like, this place where you can wave at a boat. That wasn't what we got. Like, we got towards the mouth of the river, and the bushwhacking basically halted us in our tracks. And we couldn't even get to the point where the mouth of the river was. So we picked a point of shoreline kind of to the south, realize, like, visibly these guys are looking for us at the mouth of Rainbow Creek, and we're not there. And I started to get worried. I was like, oh man, what if they, like, don't see us and they just, like, leave? And we're just stuck here. There was no place for a tent even. Like, this is crap bush. Anyway, so Tom decided to swim out to the point, and sure enough. Tom, you know, took off his tattered clothing, swam out to the point, and I think, you know, 5-10 minutes later, James and I heard a boat, saw Tom, like, on a little mini beach waving his arms, just like Tom Hanks in Castaway. So, anyway, that concluded our journey, pretty much. Like, we're back in a civil situation on the way back to the lodge, where we spent a night bumming your food and sleeping in a yurt. Here's a picture of our retrieve method, our chosen retrieve method. It was the Cessna 182. What was his name, Eric? Yeah, pilot named Eric. Really good guy. He had Thursday off. We had arrived there on Wednesday. Perfect timing. He was able to pick us up at the Chilko Lake airstrip and flew us back practically right over the line that we flew, which was kind of cool to recap. I remember looking at, like, pretty much all the terrain.
In
45 minutes, like, we're trying to explain to him, like, yeah, dude, this, yeah, we were way higher than you, but, like, we took 5 days. Like, yeah, we got to, like, almost 13,000 feet here, but, yeah. Anyway, that pretty much concluded it. To cap it all off, Corey, as I think Tom was saying before, did make it out safe. He arranged for a plane to come and pick him up at the Fishing Lake airstrip. So he was out by then, or maybe just after we got out clean. All in all, I think the journey was quite amazing. We had all envisioned being able to fly this line in like 2 days. Like, oh, really good days, amazing, just crush it. That being said, after it all, I was kind of glad we had to do it in little steps. It really, really gets you in to the journey. Like, we were having a close relationship with the line that we chose, as opposed to flying over all the mountains you've climbed or skied for the last 2 years in one flight. Like, paragliding can't be that every single day. It's never, not a dream flight all the time. So to get up close and personal with the line like we did, and sleep in different spots throughout the trip, and just, yeah, really have a full experience. I think I was quite happy with it. Yeah, that's our journey. Do you have anything to add? Thank you, everybody, for coming out.
Yeah,
what are
you doing again?
What are you doing in July?
This year.
Are you coming? I think we would do it again. Yeah, I mean, when you do something, you know, even if it's a single day's flight, all of a sudden you get home and you realize, like, I could probably do that faster or better.
I mean,
out and return, yeah. Let's do an out and return from Chilko. I think that's very that's pretty ambitious. But you know what? Yeah, it's probably cheaper than having to pay a dude in a 182, or maybe not. Yeah, I think we would do it again.
Seems like the wind would work.
Yeah, it does northwest all the time.
Yeah, the northwest wind was, you know, at times I feared it, but at the same time, it's fairly representative of fair weather. Like, it's good flying conditions.
On Chilko for the last day, it was hand flow, so you all said.
Yeah, Chilko was blowing south on the last day. So the days prior, I think the guys that picked us up in the boat were saying it was blowing northwest for the previous days. Quite hard.
I remember an interview with Will Gadd, who was talking about crossing the Rockies and one of the insane routes that he did, and using Google Earth, and he's picking the routes, and he's going, okay, well, there's always this snow slide, you know, slack coming down the hill, should be a good spot, and so he had to use one, and then one day he realizes there's the alders, you know, 20 feet high, and yeah, that's what the LZ was.
Oh,
I
can
imagine trying to pick LZs out of the
back. Yeah, that's a good point, honestly. It was the line that we chose. You really had to get into these little tiny details because there weren't many of them. There weren't many little details that screamed out, you can land here, along certain parts anyway. And that's a big one, is trying to determine, is that beautiful green meadowy looking thing actual meadow or is it alder? And I've actually, over the years, like I go down wormholes on Google Earth sometimes. I think some of you could probably relate to some extent, trying to plan, you know, ski trips, flights, hikes, whatever. I definitely look very closely because, yeah, in certain places. Yeah. Totally, yeah. If you're looking at an old image, that could lead you in a bad spot. Alder's no joke. I know it well.
John, were you all on
sea wings? Yeah, we were all in sea wings, yeah.
04 versus
Albinus? Yeah. Yeah, Corey was on an Arctic. Yeah. Arctic 5 or. Yeah, I think it was an Arctic 5. Yeah.
So, yeah, had done that in, like, let's say, late August or so, do you think it would have been easier, or
you
harder, like the river might actually be a bit lower?
Yeah, I think in August, I'm not quite sure. I mean, I look at Pemberton flying conditions, you're statistically more likely to get better conditions throughout July than throughout the entirety of August. That being said, I think once you're in the big mountains, you know, once you're out of the main valleys where it can, you know, be quite baked out, as one would say, once you're in the big mountains, you know, there's probably quite a few good days in August as well. But I think I wouldn't trust it as much as mid to end of July, just based on what I've experienced throughout the years that I have been flying. Like, July seems to be very, very nice.
Partly too on the safety aspect of launches and landings, you know, snow is really a key part of finding a good launch site, landing site, and having water to drink. So there was maybe more than we'd expected last year, but you know, we never had any problems finding water or having a good place to launch.
What do you take for a store? Google MSR?
Yeah, I have like, I don't have a jet boil. I have one of those little tiny little foldable stoves. And it's a little pocket rocket. It's actually a little bit lighter than a jet boil, but then I think it's a trade-off. Like, a jet boil, proper jet boil is quite efficient, so you're going to be able to boil water way faster, whereas mine, technically, you're not supposed to have a wing guard on it, kind of a, it's probably less efficient, but yeah, you know, every gram counts sometimes, and if it's what you own, and it works, yeah. What kind of stove is it?
I have a jet boil at times.
James got jet boil.
Yeah, maybe if we could stick to our ground rules a bit better, we could pack one stove and three versus that.
Yeah, who gets to carry the stove?
Oh, man. Who's chasing you?
What would you recommend for someone who actually wants to start?
Start a hole?
maybe I can take it on just because I haven't been really doing it for very long. And probably you guys have flown the least. I think my philosophy with flying safer, what we're talking about tonight was, totally going against what we just talked about for the last hour and a bit. But, why would I fly something dangerous if there's something that's interesting and exciting that I haven't flown before that's safer and easier? And I think I've tried to, progress my flying systematically in places that are new to me, and that, I should have flown all the safe places before, endeavor to go on the more challenging or remote places. So I think Vol-Biv is the same. Find a line that you can get lots of information on, that's easy and close, like in Pemberton, the line out to Goat is a great one that has a reasonable landing launch site and reasonable places to pitch a tent, and in the next day, and the next day is a total bust, you can just spawn in the valley and it's all good. You could even so much as do it in the Fraser Valley. You could fly somewhere on top line the same site you've landed and camp there for the night. And use that as a way to test your equipment and your packing and whatnot for the first time.
I think starting out, I remember my first Vol-Biv, it was like totally solo. I didn't know anybody else in the pilot community really. I was just like, oh my god, the Vol-Biv? This is amazing, fly camping. I think a really good thing to have in the back pocket is the ability to hike out. If you're going to try your first Vol-Biv, because for me anyway, being solo on my first Vol-Biv, I went through the wild rides overnight when the outflow started, and I'm like, oh my god, it's blowing north. I can't get out of here with the wing. I need to be able to hike out here, and I could. It was a bigger hike, but I think that would be a nice feature to have to your first Vol-Biv trip, and maybe snow. If you time it right, snow is very safe, quite a bit safer to land and launch from. That would be my advice, and as well, just practicing packing your kit. Like, pack your kit before you fly with it. Put your whole flying kit and your camping kit into a bag before you depart on this journey. Like, just make sure everything fits well. Make sure you don't get to launch and you're just figuring out how to fit all your camping gear in your harness for the first time. Like, that's just a recipe for disorganization, and therefore it'll get you into potentially a whole heap of problems in the air right after launch.
And I think, even building on that, like the changing, we've all heard about, changing the conditions and changing one thing at a time, to fly a new site with a new wing, and I think really same thing applies to a Vol-Biv. You need to be comfortable top landing, you need to be comfortable with camping,
how many
you need to be
comfortable.
On my ball?
Yeah, new flight, new site, new glide.
Oh, yeah.
Well, hopefully he was flying on the trip with hundreds of flights.
Yeah, I took the old one, yeah. That's another thing, brand new stuff, brand new gear, maybe, just keep it tame. Top landing can be pretty for real. Like, it can be beautifully easy a lot of the times, but at the same time, like, it's totally different than landing in a field. So if you're gonna go in Vol-Biv somewhere, all new gear, new wing, maybe you wanna play around with that first for a good number of hours before you go try and stuff it on the side of a mountain or a ridge in quite strong conditions. That's a good point. But yeah, the Volt that I brought here was my old one. It had like 300 plus hours on it. Yeah, I knew it well, so I could stuff it in anywhere if I need to.
Thanks for having us.
announcement about Bolt 4, Zengi flying Bolt 4.
Yeah.
Just on the way here, I was talking to James Rogers. You guys know James?
Yeah.
He was flying Pemberton today. And he reached out to do something with his instrument. And his brake disappeared. The pulley fell off.
Oh,
no. FYI. The pulley just blew apart. He had his brake. And he was at ridge height. He had to go up and land with just his
innovation.
Yeah, but
maybe
like,
he took it as a reinforce.
Yeah, just
got earlier. Maybe it's just like that.
A little salt air. Maybe salt water.
He didn't let him. But you know, maybe there's like a little
Pulley.
Yeah. No, exactly. I'm just saying. That's what
anyway, thanks for coming, guys. We just got to close this up so we can.